Tactical box 8821, tension engine 84, ladder regulator 65. Buyers reported 4534 Waddingbrook Drive, a dwelling. Tactical box 8821, tension engine 84, ladder regulator 65. Buyers reported 4534 Waddingbrook Drive, a dwelling. Companies operate on the west band.
My name is Jen Varga. I'm an English teacher here at the high school. I am fortunate enough to know the Gonzalez family. Actually, we grew up with Mrs. Gonzalez, and we went through the school district together, so that is what brought my attention to this. I really wanted to do something special. Angel is my student. I'm class advisor for 2018, which is the freshman class, so when everything happened with them and their house burned down, I asked the members of my band if they would help us out and perform a concert. They would donate their time so that we could sell tickets to raise funds for the family, and they were all so kind enough to do that for us. So here for you tonight, we're going to start off with Midtown Express.
This is the Gonzalez family, who lost their home to a fire on April 15, 2015. Jen Varga, an English teacher at Ben Salem High School, asked members of her band, CTO Midtown Express, if they would perform a concert to aid the Gonzalez family. And sure enough, the band members said yes. Luckily, O-Chin was able to have a chance to speak with Ms. Varga.
Well, I have Angel as a student, and I'm also one of the class advisors for the class of 2018, which his younger brother is part of Carlos. And I just really felt that we should do something because they're members of our community, members of our school district, and I also went to school with their mother way back in the day. We actually grew up together, so I really wanted to do whatever I could to help out.
The tragic news of the fire spread through the community, causing groups like Team Exclusive, CTO Midtown Express, and the general public to show up and show their support.
I was shocked. I knew that things like this happened, but you know, you hear it on TV all the time. You never think it happens to you or to people you know. And I just felt so bad for them, and I knew it was going to be a really long, hard struggle. So I really felt I needed to do something.
A GoFundMe account was created to help the Gonzalez family rebuild with the goal of $10,000. In just 1 month, they raised over $5,000. Reporting for Ben Salem, Nick Jones, Ben Salem OTM.
Be shooting stars just passing by. You'll be coming home with me tonight. We'll be burning up like neon light. Be still my heart, cause it's freaking out. It's freaking out right now. Shining like stars, cause we're beautiful. We're beautiful right now. You're all I see in all these places. You're all I see in all these faces. So let's pretend we're running out of time. Of time. Baby, when they look up at the sky, we'll be shooting stars just passing by. Don't come back.
Statue of Liberty stands on an island in New York
Now, We have a lot of ninth grade students who've done excellent work and achieved straight A's. Please, as I call you, try to line up alphabetically so we can get to your course, because we don't know who you are. Adrian Brookins, Paige Dennis, Erica Edwards, Isha Vagil, Destiny Hempsey, Jasmine G. Mary, Leah Kang, Neha Coley, Allison LaRue, Jason Lee, Joel Matthews, Victoria Moser, Zelina Gwen, Javia Olga, Edwina Osama, Adita Patel, and Gianni Patel, Keyshawn Patel, Neha Patel, Shivani Patel, Ron Patel, Lisa Perez Mendoza, Justin Bakowski, and Simonette Trez. Thank you. County Orchestra are Joshua Mahoney, Judy Cannon, and Larry
Mike Allen, Nick Bari, and Matthew Snyder. Please come forward. They are starting for Drumline, they were promoted midseason to the top division. Honoring Colin Bruce, Leah Carter, please hold your applause to the end. Rebecca Davis, Christopher Donahoe, Colby Eaves, Erica Iyer, Andrew Fass, Cortez Hicks, Valerie Holmes, Stella Hope, Alexis Jones, Matt Jones, Kyrie Jordan, William Lewis, Darby McAdams, Casey McAdams, Jennifer Newey, Katarina Pascella, Jerry Potts, Adam Russell, and Brian Clark.
Next, I'm going to call the names and Matthew will spring. Johnny Antoni, Bobby Rothman, Crystal Brooks, Linus Buckley, Rebecca Davis, Christopher Donahoe, Danielle Falciani, Jonathan Falciani, Andrew Fossey, Aaron French, David Erskine, Aaron Goldman, Lauren Goodman, Ortiz Hicks, Mark Rabbit. Cortez, Just Spoke Honey, Kayla Hope, Shelby Park, Simonette, Rodney McGann, Casey McGann, Thomas Murray, Jennifer Nugent, Alex Peasy,
second team Golden Team, and those kids are not invited tonight.
although my coaches would wish they would be invited, all right, we're kind of holding strong with that thought process. That thought process, tonight is night of champions. We must make first team only. We must make first team Bucks County Current Times Golden Team, which includes the Indians and the Woods and the Holy Ghost and the Village Jones and et cetera. You must make it to the district or the state level and be recognized at a bigger level than just lower Bucks County. It means a lot to me if you are getting awarded in the next 15 or 20 minutes. All right? Every one of you and your teammates have worked hard all year long, but you guys saw past it. And something I explain to athletes all the time is, and it goes the same for band, et cetera, it's very difficult to achieve something you can't see. If you can see a finish line, you can kind of talk yourself and will yourself into getting to that finish line. But when you're in that dark tunnel and there is no light in that tunnel, that's a very difficult process. Especially for the seniors, you've done it the last 4 years. You've done it in the off season, you've done it in the weight room, you've done it up in the track, you've done it in the basketball court, football field, et cetera. You've put in that time and you've kind of gone through that tunnel and you finally now see the light. Juniors and sophomores and freshmen, a couple things. One, if you're here, it's a huge honor to make it with your peers around the county. Second, next year this will be in our brand new cafeteria, and I promise I hate to sweat, so bring us sweatshirts because it will be much colder next year. I promise you that. And before I get started, the last thing I want to say is, as I said at the start, Miss Hope did a great job kind of getting your attention, and there's no microphone, and it's a little toasty in here. I got big shoes to fill, okay? Big shoes to fill. As you guys all know, Miss Hope is retiring, effective next fall, and I will have to run this show next year. That is big shoes to fill. So real quick, I'd like a round of applause for Miss Hope. Tonight is the easy and fun part. If you've seen Miss Hope or Miss Hope's office in last week, it's like a war zone. I'm staying away from it. I'm not looking forward to that aspect, but I am looking forward to continuing the nice tradition and hopefully living up to Miss Hope's standards. As you guys know, our football coach left after this season, and we kind of started in a new direction. It's a little different category that we're honoring right now. We're going to honor some freshman football players in a minute. Some of these kids play for the school team, some of these kids do not. They're actually from the Ramblers organization, but I signed off on most of their vacation request forms. They came up in early December, and they had an opportunity to go down to Florida, I believe Orlando, and compete in a national competition. I will say the one caveat that is to those freshman football players we're looking at is every single one that will be on the school team next year. All right? That's one of the reasons you're here tonight. But we will build from the ground up, and that's what the freshman stuff is all about. So I'd like to call up Andrew Fiorelli, Greg Janowski, Christopher Peters, Dylan McNichols, Isaiah Murray, Steve Paris, Jonathan Rebel, Rob Ritzky, Andrew Montanoni, and Tyree Singleton. Five kids on Division I last year, which to me as an AD is a huge accomplishment. You know, just to play Division III, to play JUCO, to play Bucks County Community College is a huge accomplishment, okay, to be the best of the best. But to go to Division I, okay, where it is a full-time job, where you sometimes get back to your dorm room at 11 o'clock, 11:30 at night, class still starts at 9 o'clock the next morning. I can't imagine to play at that level and the hard work that you put in. But after that Division I luncheon, I kind of thought about what went well, what didn't go well. And the one thing I really thought about is, what about the kids that went D2? What about the kids that went D3? What about the kids that went JUCO? So this year, due to construction, I want to honor any kid that's going to play collegiately next year. I will let you know, and not to scare you, but just so you know what you're ahead for, right, it gets that much harder. Right, to play next year in college, where your off-season is double the length of off-season in high school, where the coaches will monitor your weight room activity, where the coaches will monitor the way you eat, all right, and make sure you're building up the strength and lean muscle. All right, it is a full-time job. I do understand why some college athletes want to be paid. All right? And I know big sports, football and basketball, get on ESPN all the time, but every athlete works as hard no matter what the sport is. So I'm going to call up the young student and talk about their sport and what college they're going to. So you can hold it close to the head. I'll line them up, and I promise parents can get the picture. Alphabetically, we have Amelia Ali competing in track, specifically distance shot put at Dartmouth College. Chelsea Briggs is playing softball next year at Newman University. Stephanie Brooks will still be competing in women's track up at NYU, New York University. Chris Calder will be playing baseball next year at Philadelphia University. Next year, if the microphone does not work, I'm asking Mrs. Calder to help me. My neighbor. Cinco will be playing soccer next year at Charleston Southern University. Brandon Edward will be playing basketball at Leidner University. Mel will be following Rich Duncan Murphy 2 years ago to go play football at Marist College up in New York. We'll be going fast on the football field next year. Alexis Goldview will be pitching softball next year at Delaware State University. Henry Lyle will be competing in boys track at Arizona State University. All athletes usually sit here night champions, and boys track always stays in that corner. Taiji Mays will be competing in cross country for Temple University. I promise you, who's passing now? I'll see you. Jackie Morell will be pitching next year for Kutztown University. Young lady didn't even play this year due to injury and still was in every game. Rihanna Rock playing soccer next year at Holman Campus University. She's done good this year, but she's still got a scholarship to be playing her senior year because of her injury. One of the smartest kids in the school, Kayla Ron, will be playing soccer next year at Wesley College. Competing in track, Jason Tate, East Stroudsburg University. I'll get this wrong, but I want to... Discus at New Hampshire University, Hani Trabulsi. Yeah. And lastly but not least, Nicole Lodge playing soccer next year for Cedar Crest College. One more time, give these athletes a round of applause.
Thank you.
sure that Nick Mulvey is playing baseball next year for Quinn Hart University. Come on up, Nick.
Thank you.
Seymour League and National Conference. Like Lyric, I put those same expectations on her shoulders next year to lead our bowling team. In addition to her individual accolades, also some team accolades. But I will tell Sarah, like I tell Lyric, when you're a junior, you know, when you're a senior, like Sid, it's nice, your senior is gone. When you're a junior, it's that much harder. Everyone is coming at you next year. Every coach talks about you in the locker room. Just, you know, whatever sport we're talking about, this team's bowling, we got to beat Sarah's score. This is what Sarah's going to score for a team sport. All right, so it's a lot harder when you get to the top. We've got to compete to the top here this year. The pressure's on. But I'm hoping next year Sarah will be up here as a three-time league champion, first team all league. One more time, Sarah Shane. I'm going to start with Spiriton or no? All right, come on up, Bill. Without the hat.
I'm going to carry you.
As you guys can read from Dylan's accolades, he got All-State, he got All-Academic Wrestling Team, and he got All-State Academic Honorable Wrestling. I will tell you that this is Dylan's second year in a row. Again, we talked about kids coming up for academics and athletics. Dylan does both in the classroom and on the wrestling mat. Dylan will be up here next year as first team All-League. Right there, right there. All right, another junior that we're counting on big shoulders in the wrestling team. Again, another injury kind of forced him to miss some of the season, but the expectations are that Dylan will be first team all league next year in weight class, along with being first team all state in academics. All right? Give it up for Dylan Hanfair. Season right from his mom and his grandfather. I've known a long time. So Donovan looked at him to be on the football team. Thought about it, and Donovan had a nice football season. He probably got short. He got honorable mention in the current times bowling team. He got honorable mention in the league. Probably due to our team record, but we're talking about play football the last 2-3 years to come on to homecoming and have 2 sacks. Senior night, have 2 sacks. And he kind of went out in a real way. But his main sport's wrestling. That's why he's up here today. Donovan made it all the way to sectionals this year. Regionals. He made all the way to regionals this year. That's all right. He's also SNL National Conference, I will mention, All League. He's a district and regional qualifier. He was the senior leader of the wrestling team. There is good hands for next year. Give it up for Donovan Boyce. Of our throwers from our girls' track team. I know Coach Gaines wants to come up with me. There she is. Please add whatever you'd like to add. Amelia Lanning, come on up. So Coach Woodwall's in the back trying to hide. He's our head girls track coach for cross country, indoor and outdoor. But to show his unselfishness, these two girls are throwers, and he has multiple assistants. This is his throwing assistant coach. And he's like, no, you need Reed up there. Reed gets all the credit. So I'm going to read the next girl. Thanks. I hope I don't push this. In indoor track, Amelia, who we've seen many times up here tonight, was a state qualifier, shot put made up from Penn State. In spring track, Amelia, I'm sorry, let me start with my junior. I'm double. Go back to my junior. All right, you got Elena in discus got second place at SOLs this year. She got seventh place at District 1 championships. Elena Van Arfield. Stuff I'm going to say about Amelia right now, I'm going to say about Elena this time next year. Alright, good answer. In indoor track, for the second time Amelia was the state qualifier in shot put. She also got third in districts, and she also set the school record. Give it up for Amelia Lee. For discus, Amelia is a three-time first-team All-League SOL National Conference. For shot put, she is two-time honorable mention SOL National Conference, and that's her second throw, and she plays eighth place, even though her main thing is discus, even shot put. She got eighth place. Amelia will be competing at Dartmouth College next year in discus and shot put. She was our low representative to make it to states this year for the girls' track team. And again, another one that does it in the classroom and obviously out on the field. Give it up for Amelia. Hello. couple key seniors from boys track. I expect that 70, the other right number up here, to be more like 17 next year. All right, our last award before we get our special award to get you guys out of here. It's not in the program because for some reason the baseball coaches could not get together until just at the end of last week. But this year, representing boys baseball, just like an intern at Winter Varsity did, Nick Mulvey was first team all league in center field. We have two special football awards we give out every year in remembrance of two star football players that tragically lost their lives at a young age, represent us back in the 70s and 80s. Both awards stand for different things. I'm going to start with the Ron Vogelheim World Award. And it's just the Ron Vogelheim World Award doesn't necessarily mean you're the best player, doesn't mean you're not the best player. You're just that kid that every coach loves. You're the first one to practice, you're the last one to leave. Want to get extra reps, extra film study, extra time in the weight room. Coach, someone gets hurt, coach, I'll play that position. You're the selfless leader on that team that's willing to do anything and just continually get better. You're the kind of kid that a coach says you can try to make your son. So with that being said, this year's Ron Vogelheim winner is Aaron Banks. Team MVP with the biggest heart that does whatever it needs for the coach. I can't talk about this kid enough. He probably played of the 22 starting positions about 14 this year. He went, maybe sat out 14 plays in 11 games. One more time, Devontae Porter.
Freshman year, you're not eligible for varsity letters. So they receive the maximum of the time varsity letters. Great. Okay, I don't really have to explain much, except it's really an honor to be here. There's about 40 or 50 of my former students. It warms my heart to see all these kids that I had for a year or maybe 6 or 7 years to be up here, be the biggest, the best, and the brightest that we have. So congratulations to all of you, but especially the Belmont kids. Great job. I'd like to call up Francesca Valla. Alex Ramirez. Francesca's going to Bucks, is that correct? Bucks County Community College. Stephanie's going to NYU, that's New York University. Henry Lyon is going to go to Arizona State University, he's not up here. And Alex is going to be Army National Guard. Quinn Professor. Nine varsity letters, that's amazing. Congratulations.
Before we do our last report, real quick, I just want to thank one more time the parents in this room. We give a round of applause to all the parents in this room. My oldest child is Hayden. I've played a couple sports, but I'm just experiencing now what you've lived for the last 7 years of your life, which is no life. Get up every weekend morning, you drive your kids to AAU and travel to the gym, to this kind of workout, to this club team. I hope all the students in this room, and this isn't just athletics, this is everything. Hope all the students will really appreciate the parents who are going to take care of you, because you wouldn't sit here right now, and I don't mean literally, I mean for your accomplishments, if your parents didn't dedicate their minds to you and make sure that you had the best of everything, it was new seats or a new glove or a new helmet or a new instrument and the travel ring to get the way to take. So one more time for parents. Our last award of the night is the Alumni Association for Athletics Award. It's a pretty simple award. It's excellence in athletics. You must excel. You must play, whether you play ball or sports and letter, or whether you're one sport, you just excel in that sport year round. Again, these two individuals have been up here before. I've talked about their accolades. They'll be sorely missed next year. Two of the leaders in this building, in the classroom, out of classroom, on the field. Our speed round recipient is Sid Doherty. Excellence in athletics is Donovan Williams.
Thank you. thank you for choosing to spend your evening with us and raising funds for the students of Lake Santa Township School District. I just wanted to, they're kind of hurrying their way out, but I did want to thank the Ben Salem High School Jazz Band and their director, Mike Zimmerman. Providing such nice music as we all gather here. I also wanted to take a moment to thank our gala committee members who did a great job pulling everything together for us to all enjoy this evening. Our gala committee was chaired by Tammy Wood Mogul, who is a Ben Salem Education Foundation board member, as well as a district employee. We have two other board members who also helped Tammy on the gala committee, Jeanette Schilling and Mark Cohen. And we had some community members, Susie Byback and Kathy Sullivan, who also were on that committee. So let's give them all a big round of applause. I also just wanted to take a moment to acknowledge the rest of the foundation board so that you know who they are, and hopefully we'll get around to chat with you at some point this evening. Not everyone was able to make it tonight, but they send their regards. Dr. David Baugh, the superintendent of schools, is on our foundation board, and he did send his regrets because he had a conflict and wasn't able to attend. We also have board members that weren't already mentioned, Bill Lewis, CJ Mills, Heather Nicholas, who is one of our two school board liaisons, Kevin McKay, who is our other school board liaison, Stacy Cutner, Caitlin Reese, who is one of our, is a student representative on our board, Tony O'Malley and Chris Hine, both retired teachers from the district who are part of our board, and our newest member, Dan Tran. So these people all volunteer their time in some capacity helping us run the foundation, and hopefully you'll get to chat with those one or two of them this evening. Finally, before I introduce tonight's speaker, I'd also just like to take a moment to thank our sponsors. They are listed in your program books on your table, so I hope you'll have a moment to look through that and thank them, and certainly on behalf of the entire board, we thank them for coming to the gala and for supporting our event this evening. There was one person or group that was not mentioned in the program, so I just did want to pay a special thank you to the office who donated all the printing needs for this evening. So now I'm going to introduce tonight's speaker as he comes home to us in Ben Salem. Jeff Skaversky is a Ben Salem High School graduate. So without further ado, please help me welcome Jeff Skaversky.
It's great to be here. I want to thank everyone for having me out here to talk about Ben Salem. I especially want to thank all the teachers I had over the years, especially the ones that I was disruptive in my report card. That was extremely fun taking those home. You know, I think about, and people ask me all the time, how did I end up on Channel 6 growing up here in Ben Salem? Like many of you, I'm sure, is watching the show and watching the news for as long as you can remember. And sometimes I wonder, too, how did I in the world end up here? These days I sit next to Jim Gardner. And I remember the first time sitting down next to Jim and Dave Roberts thinking, what am I doing in the world as a kid from Ben Salem? How did I end up here? What possibly went wrong? But, you know, I think back to how I got started. And to be honest, to be really honest, it all started with the audiovisual program at Ben Salem High School 20 years ago, and I really think that changed my life. When I was at Ben Salem High School, I didn't really know what I per se wanted to do when I first got to Ben Salem High School in ninth grade. And I said to myself, okay, well, I like to talk, disruptive in class apparently, and I like sports, so let's put that combination together. And I entered the audiovisual program about 20 years ago, so my junior year, and it just felt right. Everything felt natural for me. And at Ben Salem High School, it started for me. I was making videos. I was doing play-by-play of the basketball team. I was making soccer, football, basketball videos, and I remember putting those together. And Doctors Worm, used to be at the school, I would say is one of the most influential people in my entire career. He started everything for me and really helped me from the ground up. And By the time I went to college, I felt a lot more prepared and a lot more ahead of the game than I think every other student that was coming in here saying the same thing, that they wanted to be a sports announcer one day. They wanted to be on the news. And it's interesting. I haven't told a lot of people this, and a lot of people don't know this about me because it's not something I like to talk about per se, but I think since we're kind of in this education thing, when I was younger, I had a really bad reading comprehension problem. I mean, it was really bad, and I remember getting help. I remember one of my teachers, Mrs. Halperin, really worked at it with me. And I remember Benjamin Rush and Snyder and Ben Salem High School, teachers would call upon me to read out loud as they do in class. And I remember I was always very nervous and embarrassed sometimes to read, just very nervous that I wouldn't sound good when I'm reading. And I had trouble a lot of times remembering the things I would read. And now I get paid to read, so it's... still can't remember everything, but that to me is that transformation. There's so many things you grow up, when you grow up, you're not good at. I mean, you have to learn everything from scratch. And I remember as a kid, I was so bad at reading, and it was such a struggle for me. And now it's all I do is read and read and read and read. And I remember the work I put into it, and it was hard. When you're not good at something and you're failing at something, it was really, really difficult. And I think at a young age, even though I didn't realize it at the time, looking back, I could honestly say going through that struggle of the fear of getting called upon in class to read out loud was one of my biggest fears. And now I do it all day long every day. To think back at that, I think that helped prepare me for the struggle and the career path of getting, for me, which is my dream job, which is working at Channel 6 and being a sportscaster. When I entered the audiovisual program, it changed my life. Because at that point, I realized, hey, there is something that I'm interested in. It was hard for me in class to pay attention. I remember as a kid, I have ADD, my mind's racing, it's all over the place. And I remember, for whatever reason, being in that class just focused me. You know, the first ever person I ever interviewed on camera was Chris Mullen, which is Mr. Mullen, who's his brother, who's now the basketball coach. He was an assistant at the time. And Chris Mullen was the first person I ever interviewed. And I think I was a junior at Ben Salem, and I did it for OTN. And I remember I was very nervous. I mean, this guy is a 4- or 5-time NBA All-Star. He's on the Olympic team. I mean, this guy is one of the best basketball players in the business. And he was coming to talk to the Ben Salem basketball team as a favor to his brother. And I remember hearing about it. And I remember in my head saying, well, that would be a good story for our TV show for OTN. There's this big NBA star over at Armstrong where they used to practice and play games. And I went over there and I interviewed them. We played it on the news and we played it on the local cable access channel. And I remember then it kind of started clicking for me that, you know what, this feels kind of right. I wasn't any good at it, but it felt somewhat right. For me, it all started here. And I was able to overcome the reading comprehension, and I found different ways to learn from that. And found different ways to get through that. I mean, I still have days now where I'm reading articles or I'm reading something online or in the newspaper or wherever, and I was like, I missed that. Let me go back. Or I'll highlight it. I used to in newspapers when I was looking up information and different things for years, I would write all over the newspaper. And I remember when I interned at Channel 6 when I was in college, I remember looking at Gary Papa's desk. You know, all these newspapers and all sorts of nonsense scribbled all over the place, numbers and things circled. And, you know, Gary was a lot like that too. I think your mind's kind of all over the place, kind of running the ADD, the ADD kind of thing, maybe a little bit of the reading comprehension, and just finding ways to connect. And whether you grew up with a learning disability, whether you grew up struggling with math or whatever it is, I think there's ways to find a way to connect with the material, because everybody in your, as you can attest to, your kids or yourself learn a different way. So for me, when I left Ben Salem, getting out of Temple University, I have to tell you, I was ahead of the game by 2 years easily. Calling all the basketball games and football games, I went right into Temple, and I was able to cover the Phillies, the Flyers, the Eagles, and Sixers for our campus radio station. So I did TV, I did radio, I wrote for the newspaper at Temple University, and I felt like I was ahead of the game. And I took it very seriously. I said, okay, this is something I can connect with. Nothing else in high school, for me, or even in elementary school or middle school, I really felt like I could connect with. But for whatever reason, the TV, the journalism, the media stuff really connected with me. And I just went for it. And I'm talking about, I'm in class all day long, 8 in the morning to 2 in the afternoon. I would go to an internship. I was interning at different periods at Comcast Sportsnet, at Channel 17, and at Channel 6. And I remember thinking, hey, I just want to be one of those guys. And I just started sending out demo tapes as I was leaving Temple University. I was doing TV, radio, newspaper, sending out demo tapes. I sent out about 100 demo tapes. Nothing, not a single response, zero. And then I sent out about 50 more, so I'm at 150. And I get a call from Fargo, North Dakota, which sounds just pleasant, especially in December. So I remember thinking, I really don't want to go to Fargo, North Dakota. And Gary Papa had said to me, he was my mentor when we started becoming very friendly, said to me, just take it. He said, you'll be there a year, and then you'll get out of there. It doesn't matter. Just take it. So I accepted on the phone. And then the next day I got offered a job at the ABC station in Macon, Georgia, which is a startup ABC station. They had no ABC news down there. It's a startup TV station. Went down to Macon, Georgia. My parents helped me move down there after sending out 150 tapes. I'm excited to start this journey of being on television. And I get down there and they tell me, hey, by the way, just to let you know, we ran out of money. We're not going to be doing the weekend news anymore. I'm supposed to be the weekend sports announcer. I said, hey, we ran out of money, so sorry. I said, well, why are we doing it? Well, you could be a cameraman, or I don't know. So imagine like picking up everything. You don't really have any money. If you think about where you're out of school, you don't really have much money. You move down to Macon, Georgia. You have an apartment. You have a furnished apartment. It was one of the most devastating points of my career, and it just started. I just finished Temple University. And I remember talking to Dr. Zwirn. I remember talking to different people in college and mentors of mine. A lot of them said to me, this is what it is. And I remember I thought back to things that I learned at Ben Salem High School doing OTN. And it's not going to go well. In fact, most of the time it's not going to go well. Most of the time, whether you're on TV, whether it's behind the scenes, things are not going to go well. It's how you handle it on the fly. I got a job in Atlantic City at the NBC station, and to me, that was a dream I consider first job. And I left Macon after 6 weeks, and I started working in Atlantic City, and it was great. I was doing a little bit of Eagles coverage, a little bit covering the Phillies, and we covered a lot of minor league stuff, and you kind of get your feet wet, where you can make mistakes, you can just be flat out bad on television, and mumble and stutter all over the place, even more than I do now on Channel 6. And it's okay, it's fine. And then from there, I wanted to move up. And the process is, I try to compare it to minor league baseball, where you start off in the minors and you work your way up, single A, double A, triple A, and so on and so forth. So from there, I went to Syracuse, and I get to Syracuse, and it's just fly out off. It's just the worst job ever. It's terrible. The money's bad. It's cold. It snows every day. And I kept thinking to myself, my dream is I want to work at Channel 6. I want to do this. I can put up with this for a few years. You're away from home. You don't really know anyone. You don't have a lot of friends. You're in a different place. And you're learning the teams. You're learning the coaches. You're learning the PR people. And you're starting from scratch. And I sent out from there about... took me about 300 demo tapes, 300 more tapes, where I would put together a highlight reel of my best material. I would send it out and just pray that somebody would call me and offer me a job, maybe. And I sent out 300 tapes and not a single word, not a peep. So at this point, I'm at about 450 tapes into my career, and about a year and a half, no, I'm sorry, about 4 years into my career, I'm about 450 tapes in, and I have one call, one job, and that's been it. And I send out more tapes and more tapes and more tapes, and I finally get a job in St. Louis, which really started to feel like, okay, well, this might happen here, where this is going to turn into something okay. Because St. Louis is considered a big market. It's a major league market with an NFL team, a major league team. And I was working out in St. Louis and covering major league stuff. It felt great. Covering, as we heard, the World Series and covering NFL teams, traveling with teams. It started to feel like a job in Philadelphia for me where, okay, this is going to prepare me to come home one day. So I continued to send out demo tapes and continued to want to move up in the business. I was in St. Louis for about 2 years. I was close a few times to some different jobs here in Philadelphia. And about 2008, when the market crashed and the economy tanked, I got laid off in St. Louis. And I had been very close to a few jobs, as I said, here in Philadelphia. And again, devastating. I thought back to the Macon situation. I thought back to working in Macon, Georgia, and the ups and downs of working in this business that I wanted to do so much. And at that point, I said to myself, well, I can sit here in St. Louis with no job, or I can try to make something happen and hustle. And I remember thinking just back to high school. And I remember conversations I had with doctors, one telling me about, hey, listen, most people don't make it, and whether you've made it this far, whether you're going to make it and get a job on the news in Philadelphia one day, whatever it is, you just got to keep fighting through it and keep getting through it. So I decided when I was in St. Louis and after I got laid off, I left my apartment out there and I just flew home. And I started basically banging on news directors' doors in New York and Philadelphia, Baltimore and Washington. And when I got laid off in July of 2008, I made a decision. I said, okay, am I going to sit here and stand pat, or am I going to continue to hustle and make something out of nothing? At this point, I had nothing. And I continued to send out tapes and tapes and tapes and tapes and tapes and tapes. Nothing. So I started freelancing. I got some work in Baltimore. Got some work in Washington. I started doing some radio updates on 97.5 here with Mike Missanelli. And all of a sudden, I was working 7 days a week. One day, I was working at 97.5. Another day, I was in Baltimore. Another day, I was in Washington working at different TV stations. All sorts, I'm all over the place, up and down I-95. And then I started freelancing at Fox 29. And the news director at Fox 29 at the time had been a news director in St. Louis at another station who I got in contact with. And I really try to think outside of the box. Okay, I'm in a bad situation. I'm laid off. I don't know when I'm going to get work again as far as getting another on-air sportscasting job. And I said, okay, well, what am I going to do here? Again, I can sit here and stand pat, or I can make my own breaks. And I started doing that. And I remember from my internship at Channel 6, when I worked there in college, an intern, I called up a lot of people I'd stayed in contact with, and I said, we're going to have an opening here. We've seen you on Fox. We've seen your demo tape. The news director had remembered me from when I was an intern and said, okay, we'd like to bring you in for an interview. And to me, at that point, I was like, this is it. This is everything I've worked at since the time I was at Ben Salem, since the time I walked in on OTN and calling basketball and football games. This has prepared me for my dream job. And as no, now I got the job, and it to me that felt like a vindication for all the hard work, everything you put into, everyone telling you, hey, it's not going to work out, and all the ups and downs of the day-to-day, how tough it is. And at the point when I got the job at Channel 6, I had sent out 1,000 demo tapes. I mean, you think about the process of putting together a highlight reel of your work over the course of 6-7 years, 1,000 demo tapes, back and forth to the post office, making labels and stuff like that. So that's kind of in the process of to get to Channel 6. And now people ask me, hey, what do you want to do next? I really just don't want to mess this up. Try not to screw this up too much. But that's kind of been the career process for me. And I thought about it the other day. I had an intern call me and ask me for some advice and different things and say, hey, he's been at this a while and it hasn't really worked for him. And I just said to myself, you know what, I've been at this 20 years. I really have. I've been at this for 20 years. So it's going to happen at different points for different people. And I really do credit the work ethic and going back to the audiovisual program that I was able to gain so much out of here at Benson High School. And I really can't thank the ability to have that program enough and what Dr. Zwirn did for me. And I've met up with him a few times. We've had a bunch. We've talked about it. So I just want to thank you guys for having me out tonight. And I really appreciate you guys watching and listening. I hope I didn't bore everyone too much and put anyone to sleep or whatever. So, but well, thanks for your time.